Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Our meeting will now come to order. At this time, we'll have our invocation by Mr. Manning.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Before I do that, may I just offer birthday greetings to our fellow Commissioner Eddie Boswell and say what a wonderful gift we have for you to spend your birthday here.
Thank you so much.
Happy birthday, Eddie. He told me 29.
When my birthday was yesterday. So.
Well, there we go.
Okay, well, happy birthday.
61, not too bad. Huh?
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the opportunity to meet and do your work, as we address important issues facing the citizens of this county. We ask that you watch over us in the coming months as we work to meet the needs of those in need, while keeping in mind the limited resources that are available to meet those needs. We ask for spring. We ask for warm weather. We pray for warm weather. And as always, Lord, watch over us and help us and guide us to do those things that you would have us do through your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, I want to recognize Mr. Kavnis, and the scouts would like to do our Pledge of Allegiance.
Very good.
So if you'll join them.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you guys for coming. Okay, the next item is introduction of Dr. Dale Burns. He is the interim superintendent of Alamance Burlington School System. And are you going to do that?
We'll be more than happy to.
Also, Mr. Rose is with him as well, Tony Rose.
School board.
Dr. Burns and I have been having lunch for the past 3 or 4 weeks since he has taken the job as interim superintendent for our school system. Been very impressed at what Dr. Burns is trying to do, a lot of the transparency that he's doing, especially with our upcoming budget and the challenges and issues that will be arising from that. But before we began our budget process with them, thought it would be a wonderful opportunity for you to meet him and for so you can put a name with a face. So Dr. Burns, thank you for coming.
Thank you. Chair Massey, Commissioners, Mr. Honeycutt, thank you for giving me a few moments just to stand before you and to say hello. I have been honored the last few weeks to meet many fine folks in Alamance County. I visited all the schools more than once, and I've seen some great things going on. There's a lot to be proud of in this fine school system, and I do appreciate the opportunity to visit and spend some time here as this interim superintendent role. Mr. Honeycutt and I have met. We've talked quite a bit. I'm learning every day, and I am looking forward to being able to serve in my capacity as we look through some very difficult times economically. This is a challenging time, and I'm sure I'll be back in front of you at some point to share information. I look forward to that as well. The other thing that I feel very privileged about is I've had the opportunity to meet some fine folks, both elected and appointed officials. And in every case, I have to say just how warm, welcoming, and accepting folks have been of me. And I appreciate that. It's a great place that you have here, and I'm looking forward to my time here, as I've said. I don't know if you'd like to ask any questions. I'm not sure I have a lot of great answers at the moment. I've only been around about 6 weeks, but if that's appropriate, Madam Chair, I'd be glad to do so.
Anybody have any questions?
I just want to make a comment about Dr. Burns. He has actually addressed the issue of the employees already and presented that before the school board, and I think he's taken a very proactive step in helping work out the budget this year, which I appreciate that considerably.
Thank you, Mr. Boswell.
And I will recognize Mr. Rose.
Stand up, Tony.
He's also on the school board.
Yes.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for coming, and we're glad to have you, and we'll call you.
Thank you, ma'am.
When it's time for the budget.
I'm sure you will. And I hope to see a smile on your face as well as mine. We'll certainly work toward that. And if it's not objectionable, at this point, I would like to turn around and let you see the back of my head as I exit and head toward another location. Thank you again, Madam Chair.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Now we'll have our public comment section, and that's John Devaney. Did I say that right? If you will come forward, please, and state your name.
John Devaney, 3246 Beaver Creek Road. It's out near Alamance Battleground. Okay. And I appreciate the opportunity to come. I want to thank Sheriff Johnson. I came by to see him last week. We got a real problem in our county. Last week, me and my wife was riding, taking a trip through the country, just going on, taking her shopping, and went to Solar City. But I left my home and hit 61 and was going to Conesville, and I was just looking at the garbage and the trash. Our county has, if you excuse my language, has gone to hell. Everywhere I go, there's nothing but trash. And I have picked this stuff up for 40 years I've lived out there. And so my wife went to town Saturday morning while I was picking this stuff up. I picked up a 5-gallon bucket. I started to bring it. But I've been picking up stuff and trying to find people's name so that I could turn it in and maybe something could be done. We see these people arrested for drugs, rape, you name it. I don't see nothing about littering out here. But it's pitiful just to see our country deteriorate the way it is. And I try to do my part picking this stuff up, but I am sick and tired of it. My horse pasture is right there on the road. I pick up beer bottle, broken glass, dead cats, dead dogs, and this is going in your watershed in McIntosh. And if we could get our governor to come out of her cocoon and get her up here and take her on a bus trip through our county and let her see what's really going on out here, maybe they'll give you what you need to get this job done. You don't have enough deputies to take care of this problem. What I was thinking coming over here, the only way that you're going to be able to do something like it, that is have one of these cameras that you can periodically put in a bridge or a road somewhere and leave it for a certain period of time so you can move it. And then we can catch these scumbags, okay? The first snow we had, the gentleman out there had planted, sowed his wheat field. Well, they took their four-wheel drive trucks and run through it. Well, then they went over to Huffman Mill Road and they went through that one three or four times. Well, the guy said, well, there's no need to me coming down there and pressing charges because it won't be nothing done.
And I apologize, I didn't tell you, you only had 3 minutes. But I will want to tell you that the prisoners, you can, I don't know who you need to see to make arrangements or whoever. Isn't that partly in Guilford County, though, when you hit 61 out there?
Yes, ma'am. And I'm going to tell you something else, too. This crazy government we got now, that's been Beaver Creek Road ever since the damn Indians come through.
Well, and I appreciate you not using your language.
Okay. But anyway.
But anyway, I just want to say that,
it's about 100 yards of it in Guilford County.
Yeah, we just need to look into it and see if we can't get some prisoners out there. Because they do go along the side of the road and pick up trash, okay?
Well, we need
and
to start.
I don't know who to talk with, but I bet my
we need to save. We need to save that trash and find some names.
Well, I don't know that you can do that, but anyway. But I appreciate it, and we'll see what we can do, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next is Ann Vaughn.
Madam, gentlemen.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
I want to talk in relation to EMS source. The national collection rate is less than 50%. EMS source is 70%+, but probably more like 81%. Medicare and Medicaid are under federal rules and regulations, and they're different for convalescent and emergency issues. We must be and stay in compliance. There are specialized forms that must be filled out. Forms are very specific that are filled out. They must have a correct base rate. Mileage rates just changed the 1st of January to 1/10 of a mile. All these things happen. In comparing rates, do these rates that you have compared include debt set off? Do they include garnishments? Other collective activities and adjustments? EMS source just collected $900,000 last year under that category, that one category. If you choose to do this in-house, will anyone be certified? There is a national ambulance certification. Remember, that's training. These people do a lot of training with our folks. There are rules and regulations that are constantly changing. Documentation, documentation, documentation. In compliance, you must be in compliance with Medicare and Medicaid. Otherwise, when they come in and check your books, and if you're not in compliance, you can receive, this county can receive a very, very heavy fine. If there is a change, collections will go down. The county went from $1.2 million to $4.4 million, and in less than 3 years brought in $10 million. Contract. On January 26th of 2009, the vote was 4-0. And I say that because Commissioner Lashley was not at that meeting, maybe sick. No, I don't remember now. On February 1st, 2010, the vote was 5-0 with praise for this company. And they also passed the contract that was to be an automatic rollover. I'm not sure where we are, where that stands right now. This company cares about the people of Alamance County. Show that you do too. And one other thing, several years ago I recommended rotating the auditing firms and nothing was done. And just very recently, Commissioner Boswell mentioned it and was told that it's too late. Well, folks, we just had an auditing report. It's not too late. Please consider that. Thank you.
Okay, next is Steve Worrell from EMS Source. Hello.
Good evening. First of all, thank you, Commissioners, for giving us this forum to speak tonight. My name is Steve Worrell. I'm the president of EMS Source. I'm an accountant by education and a CPA by profession. And I run EMS Source, and we are a specialty accounting and consulting firm focusing on the billing and collections for emergency management services and all related training and compliance that support it. We were formed in 2006, and we currently focus on municipalities and private ambulance carriers in the North Carolina market. We have had the Alamance contract since 2008, and we are very appreciative for that business, and we look at Alamance County just like we look at all of our customers, and they're more than just clients. They're partners, because our success will only depend on your success. And so we thank you for that opportunity. This, of course, we're going to come up later in the agenda. I think it's item number 9. And I just wanted to let you know that I would be available for more questions tonight if any come up. But I did want to reemphasize that all of our work is done in North Carolina. No part of our service is outsourced overseas. We are locally owned and operated. In fact, three of the stockholders, including myself, are present tonight. And when I looked at tonight's agenda packet, I just wanted to point out the following. I think Ms. Vaughn had already made the correction. Our collection rate is really 81% and not 69%. So I also wanted to point that out. And she also pointed out the items about garnishments and debt set-offs. Mainly the question is, are the other counties that you're going to look at tonight, are we comparing apples to apples when we're looking at collection rates? Now, a lot of market information is going to be viewed later on in this meeting, where you're going to look at 11 bidders in a recent bid for EMS services for Macon County. Now, one of the things that I'll point out is all but three of these companies, I mean, only three of these companies are doing business in North Carolina. Okay? A lot of these are medical billers coming in from out of state, and that's okay. That's fine, too. But once again, we just want to make sure we're comparing apples to apples when you're assessing professional service. We've had a very good track record here in Alamance County, financially speaking, and also from the citizens, because we know that our customer is more than just the management of Alamance County and the commissioners. It's the citizens. In fact, I was talking with one of Howard Coble's employees in the Graham office, and she pointed out to me how pleased she was with how well we handled an EMS billing issue with her mother. So we're always glad to hear that. And when we're talking about, I know we want a good deal for the citizens, but we also want to focus on the customer service as well. Last but certainly not least, we realize after hearing the audit report from the last commissioner's meeting, the economy is a big factor here. And like I said earlier, we feel like we're partners with Alamance County, and we want to do our part. If there's belt tightening, it's got to be done. And so what I would like to propose, if the commissioners would consider such a proposal, that we would be open to a discussion for a lower rate if we could get a longer-term contract.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
We'll discuss that more later.
Okay, the next person is Mr. John Oakes.
Commissioners, good evening. John Oakes, Burlington. I was grateful for the presentation given by Ms. Becky Loy when presenting the comprehensive annual financial report at the last meeting. I truly appreciate her skill in simplifying standard accounting principles. The bottom line, there was a $6 million decrease in the local option sales tax. We had a $4 million deficit, even though our taxes went up by $1 million. Our county savings account decreased $4 million in revenue and $1 million in expenditures. In addition to the $1 million our local taxes went up, our state and federal taxes also went up $1 million. Our county savings account represents about 12.6% of our annual general operating budget. State law mandates 8%. 8% is equivalent to only about a month and a half of money in a county savings account. That's like saying an individual has about a month and a half of savings to assist them when times get tough. At 12.6%, our county only has a little more than 2 months' worth of money in our savings account. What I and other average citizens understand is that the more government gets involved in issues, especially involving money, the more problems they create, even though most people involved in government are good people with good intentions. Honorable programs like those that work for and are associated with the Department of Social Services in our county do good things for people in our community every day, and I am thankful for them and the services they provide our community. But our nation now has a $14 trillion debt and can no longer fund programs by borrowing, or worse, printing money. We must first pay off the national debt, and then instead of spending approximately 19 cents on every dollar annually to service that debt, we empower our children and grandchildren to have the available money to fund good and honorable programs like the CFA grant, federal grant in the future. What honest and informed people understand is that any grant money being given by the federal government to local or state governments is being paid for by all of us at the local level. It is not free money, nor is it accurate to state that it is not costing the citizens of Alamance County any money. That is just intellectually inaccurate and misleading. That is why Commissioners Mr. Lashley and Mr. Sutton, in my opinion, who voted against funding travel expenses to Tampa, Florida, that were associated with the CFA federal grant given to our Department of Social Services, was the right thing to do. They voted against spending money that our country doesn't have. We have a $14 trillion debt, $14 trillion, folks. And it's getting larger every day by the tune of $4.5 billion, that's daily. Oprah Winfrey's net worth is about $1.5 billion, total net worth. The debt's growing $4.5 billion per day. And I encourage everyone to challenge me on that and do your due diligence. They, like all of us, support helping children, but they, like the vast majority of us, recognize that we cannot spend money that we do not have, whether it be money coming out of our pockets at the local level or at the federal level. I'm almost done. Not to do so is totally irresponsible and jeopardizes our entire nation's children and future generations of our children. Our current country's monetary and social problems remind me of what President Ronald Reagan said back in the 1980s. Government isn't the solution to our problem. It is the problem. I'm grateful to be able to speak to you this evening. Thank you.
Anybody have any comments from the commissioners?
Well, I need to comment to Ann's comment there about the accounting firm, and I guess now would be as good a time as any. And I talked to Craig about it today, and I think it is time that we send this out to maybe get some proposals on it and see, and maybe Craig can fill the rest of you in. It was kind of short notice. I talked to him about it. So you think it'd be a good time to talk about it now, or you want to just wait till? Okay.
We went back and did some looking. I appreciate Amy and Susan and their look. Cop Ezekiel and Loy have been our auditors since 1985. And we have rebid it out, but the last we can find has been in 1995 that it was bid out. If we are to bid this out, we must do it really now because the local government commission has to approve of the audit contract, and they need to do that by May. So we do have time to do it now. We have already started working on some template requests for proposals. And we could probably send out something either late this week or early next week and have approval by the Board of Commissioners, probably our second meeting in March, if that is the wish of this board.
Let's do it. Yeah, I don't, I mentioned it as well. I called him and not only mentioned the audit scenario. First of all, I told him, and I meant it, I wasn't real impressed with the last audit, not as far as what the information was, but I just wasn't impressed. And so I mentioned that as well as switching our bank account. You know, we're supposed to rotate our payroll. How long has it been since we've rotated that?
I couldn't tell you.
It's been a long time.
Yeah, right.
It's been a long time. And if you check back into the minutes of the meetings, if you go back far enough, I think you'll find that we voted consensus, or we voted to rotate it every 3 years, if you check into it, because we had people on the board that worked for certain banks, and one bank had it for a long time. I think one bank's had it this time. So not only the audit scenario, but I think the banking payroll, where payroll goes.
And we would be glad to look at banking as well. If the board's agreeable, that's probably if we could wait until after the budget was completed for the banking, we could probably look at that, starting July 1. But the audit contract, the request for proposal would be very easy to come up with, and we can get those out again late this week or early next week, if that's the wish of the board.
Anybody have any problems with any of this? I mean, they don't need a motion. We just need a consensus.
Consensus, I think.
For both items. So I don't have a problem with any of them.
Yeah.
What you said for both items, you're talking about for the banking situation?
Yes.
Well, Tim mentioned the payroll account. Aren't you looking at all the banking relationships?
Well, yeah, everything.
Yeah, it would be the entire banking relationship.
Not just payroll. Okay.
That's the big item.
Yeah. Okay. We're in a consensus on that. Okay. Any other comments? If not, we'll move to the public hearing. Jason Bruce is going to do that. Okay. Bruce Walker, this is the Road naming and addressing ordinance?
Actually, that's a mistake. It's, we have
Oh, is it?
Two roads to be renamed.
Okay.
One of them comes from our ordinance, and one was a volunteer renaming by, initiated by the public. Is there anybody here who wants to speak on two roads?
Well, let me open.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, there you go.
And this time I will open the public hearing, okay, now.
Anybody here to speak on that? Again, one was a volunteer renaming. It was a historical name to be
right,
corrected.
Right.
And the other one was part of our ordinance. And if you guys don't know, this is Ricky Hall. He works in the Adjusting Department, and he helps us with all that. And he finds all the – he's very passionate about getting the safety correct and everything else, so he helps very much with that process.
Does everybody know where these roads are? Mm-hmm. Check this out.
I looked at the map.
Yep, I did.
Yeah, I did not know until I looked
anybody
at the map.
Anybody have any questions on this? No.
Well, it sounds like you had the buy-in of the
yes
residents there.
Absolutely.
I'll make a motion that we go ahead and approve this.
Second.
I'll second.
I have a second over here. All in favor of renaming the roads? Say aye.
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 No favor. Okay.
Thank you.
Very
good.
At this time, I will close the public hearing.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Bruce.
Okay. And this is Troop 167. They're here finishing their citizenship in the community merit badge. So I asked them if they wanted to do public comments. They said no. But they're doing a good job. So thank you.
Thank you, Bruce. Okay. The next item is our budget amendment for the library. Hello.
Madam Chair, other board members. I believe I have two budget amendments before you. The first one is a further reduction in state aid that was mandated by the governor. The total of state aid that's been cut across the state is 3.5%, and it's an additional $1,850 for us that just we need a budget amendment on, and that will be taken out of our capital outlay for materials.
Okay. Anybody got any questions about this budget amendment?
Sounds like she's got it worked out.
Okay, we'll go ahead and approve this one. Or I'll
so
make
move.
A motion to approve it.
I'll make a motion. We approve
second.
It.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Okay.
The second budget amendment is, I'm like Dr. Burns, I'm still learning. Evidently, in November of 2009, the previous director put into motion a request for a LSTA grant, which is Library Services and Technology Act, for a mobile laptop lab. That was awarded to us in July of 2010. And we need to have a budget amendment to have a line item set up so that we can spend the money for that grant. And that grant involves the $29,552 from the grant and then a matching fund of $7,388, which we've designated will come out of the Gardner Trust Library Fund.
Okay. Any questions?
What is the Gardner Trust Fund?
The Gardner Trust Fund is a sum of money that the Gardner family designated and left to the library system. And we use it for big ticket, one-time expenses that aren't going to be recurring. It's just sort of the icing on the cake type things. It tends to go towards technology type of issues.
Okay, very good.
Any other questions?
I'll make the motion we approve that.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. The next thing on our agenda is the Little League participation fee. Mr. Haygood.
Yeah, good evening, Commissioners. I'm here this evening to request that you consider and approve a fee for the upcoming Little League baseball softball season. Our department is recommending that the county charge fees for individuals that come to our department directly for service. We're recommending a fee of $25 for one player, an additional $15 if a family has more than one child. They're signing up directly through our department. We're proposing that we would use this fee to cover uniform costs for the player, as well as we're going to, this year, we're planning to affiliate our individual sign-up kids with Little League Baseball, which some of you may have seen is a national-level affiliation. We'll be providing them not only with uniforms but with a patch that Little League requires, a form of insurance per player to protect them while they're playing, and also there's a team sanction fee so the teams can advance to play at a national level if they win locally. This $25 fee would cover those costs. The reason we're proposing this, over about the past 2 years, we've had numerous individuals and teams come directly to our department to enter our league. The traditional way to enter our league has always been through the volunteer clubs and associations that we still have, but we have had some of those have gone away in certain parts of the county. They're no longer providing service in certain areas. We've had to take on operations of certain ball fields. So what has happened is those kids are now coming directly to our department for service provision. Most of them are individuals. In fact, our last year, almost a third of our league is coming directly through us now as opposed to going through the clubs as traditionally have been. This fee would not apply to any kids or teams that sign up with any of the clubs that are currently participating in our program. It would only be individual kids who come directly to our department for service, to get on a team, to get organized, and then to play. So this would not have any bearing on fees that are charged by the clubs that currently put teams in our program. We have run this proposal, dollar amounts, and this idea by the Parks Commission, our local Little League board, and the representation from the existing clubs, and they've all been supportive of it. And in fact, this evening I have Mr. Dale Page, who's the chairman of our Parks Commission. He's here tonight, and also Mr. David Moore. David is serving on our Little League Board of Directors that helps us guide policies for this option for kids to play ball. So at this time, I would certainly entertain any questions or you may have.
What kind of dollar figures are you proposing this would raise?
We're thinking we would have maybe 20 to 25 teams that would participate with us. Little League has a minimum, I believe, of 12 players per team. So if we got 20, it would be approximately 240 kids that would be paying roughly $25. We may have some people that, you know, sign up more than one kid from their home. The math would be, it would be 240 times roughly 25. So I think it'd be a couple of $1,000. But the fees would be used to offset the cost of the service that we would be providing directly to the kids.
What about Burlington now? What are they charging in the same setup?
City of Burlington is currently charging $20. That is for resident, and then $75 for non-resident. So, in fact, most of the cities have a fee for a resident of the city and then a higher fee for a non-resident, too. And most of our clubs currently charge as well. So we felt like this would be, and I think our Parks Commission and Little League and even the club reps that we've met and talked with felt like this was a reasonable thing to expect of kids who play directly through us.
But Burlington City is not connected with Little League, are they?
No. In fact, for a number of years, our department was affiliated through Pony Baseball. It let kids, if you won locally, you got to play at a national level through Pony. We stopped that, I think it was about 6 years ago, they changed their ages, and we broke away from Pony. So we thought this would be, Little League offers a good way to get individual kids on teams. And at the same time, offer them the ability, if they win locally, they can advance. But this would be the only option for Little League baseball in the county. Yes, sir.
And we have the facilities if you get the demand.
Yes. What we feel is going to happen is, as I say, roughly a third of the kids that play through us now come directly to us. A lot of those are going to continue to come to us. They're probably going to choose to play through Little League because they can sign up as individuals. We do have some teams that come to us directly, but they will go to a club because this Little League model is going to be individual signups only. That the clubs will still take teams, the clubs will still take individuals, and they set their own participation fees.
Don't we have some now that we charge for all the other different leagues in the county, or do we?
Not through our department, no. We don't charge for any other youth sport. This would be the only youth sport option that we currently charge. But as I say, the clubs that participate, they have their own user fees.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Are there any restrictions as to being in county residents in this?
Yes. In fact, when we applied for and received a charter from Little League Baseball, only Alamance County residents are going to be able to sign up under Alamance County Little League. Now, in our club ball program, we currently have a provision in there that we allow kids to live within 3 miles of the county line. This was predominantly done due to Gibsonville and the city of Mebane. Now, we've met with the clubs. They've gone over the existing rules and made several suggested changes, which has been, it's been really good. It's been a good process. But the three-mile rule is planning to stay in. So if a kid lives outside of the Alamance County line, they would be able to play. They would have to sign up with a club. They would not be able to play under the Little League model.
But residents of the city of Burlington, for instance, could elect not to play city and go directly to
the county.
Yes, the county. Yes. And some do. We have residents from the city of Burlington that play. But they could. Yes.
Any other questions?
Okay. All right. The gentleman with the Parks Commission. First of all, can you give us a little bit of history on how that commission is formed and who's on it?
Yes, it's formed by ordinance. We have an enabling ordinance that forms that commission. We have 9 members total. Mr. Lashley is our board liaison. We also have a school board appointee. Mr. Brad Evans is from our school board. He's the appointee. And the rest are volunteers. They sign up to serve. Dale represents the northern end of the county up around the Lakeview area.
Fully supportive of this?
Yes. During our last commission meeting, our vote was unanimous to proceed. I mean, I hate personally that we have to start doing this. However, I will tell you, most all the other clubs charge, and we've had so many times that kids sign up, and if mom and daddy hadn't paid a small fee, they don't show up. There's no skin in the game, and then you end up with teams when not enough people to play, we have to drop out, and it causes all kinds of scheduling problems. So our commission was fully in support of this, and we do feel like it is a nominal fee. And again, you get other coverage that some of the clubs don't provide, like a uniform. Some clubs, the fee charged through the clubs pretty much takes care of the maintenance of the ball fields.
Any other questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
To accept your proposal, Mr. Haygood. I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Brian. Thank you, Brian.
Next is Mr. Burgess, who's going to talk about EMS billing.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. You have in your agenda packet there a memo from me and 2 documents attached to those that I'll get to in just a minute. I'm just giving a little history on this. Approximately 3 years ago, the county decided to start outsourcing the billing and collection of EMS transport fees. Prior to that, it was collected in-house with minimal success. Once we start outsourcing it, we did see a dramatic increase in revenues from that process. So we thought over the last 3 years, the process has been a good process, we think, from that standpoint. One thing we got looking at, because we are paying a fee of 10% now, which is $400,000+ a year, based on the numbers I have, I guess, which on Exhibit A would be 10% of the collected amount, which would be $440,000+. The question came up, could we do it for less in-house? And that's kind of how we got started on this, I guess. Would it be less expensive to do it in-house? And then when you start looking at that, you see, okay, can you be as successful in-house based on your collection rate as you could outsourcing? So we got into those discussions. So we got to the issue of, okay, well, let's see if we were to outsource it and send out an RFP, could we get a better collection fee than we're currently getting? So one thing led to another, and we got in touch with Macon County, which did an RFP back in December, and got the results of their RFP and saw that the rates range from, I think it was in the 4s up to 10%. So that's kind of how we got started on this project. And so what we're asking the board to do tonight is to basically not make a decision on whether we do it in-house or whether we outsource it, but let us take the next step and send the RFP out to see what the results of the RFP are. And then we can, the board, with the information we give you at that time and the information we've already given you, can then decide based on what it costs to do it in-house, what it would cost to outsource it, what collection rates you could look at in-house versus outsourcing, and then for the board to arrive at a decision as to, number one, which route you want us to go, and if you decide you want to outsource it, which firm do you want to select at that time. So that's what we're here for tonight. The next step would be just to authorize us to send out the RFP. We would probably send it out tomorrow. And let me talk a little bit about, to answer some questions or concerns you may have about the RFP process. Some of the concerns that were brought up tonight, we have included those in the RFP. We have talked with Chuck Mancellus, the EMS director, and he's been working with us on the RFP, and he's been very heavily involved in the collection part over the last 3 years, so he's very aware of their department's needs and concerns and things that the county needs to be protected against and all of those things. So we tried to incorporate those in the RFP. A couple of things that bring your attention. One was brought up about the National Academy of Ambulance Coders on page 6. It does require the firm to be certified by them, so we've addressed that issue. The issue of outsourcing to other countries on page 16, we have addressed that, and that all operations have to be in the continental United States. So we have addressed that issue. On page 11, one of the things that we're requiring is we're requiring them to give us a list of all of their governmental clients and their collection rates and how long they have been with those clients so we can compare different companies to see what their likelihood of success is as far as a collection rate goes. And the RFP is 20 pages long, and we have tried to include everything in there so that the firms that respond, if they're able to do what's in the RFP, then we feel like we will have that we will end up contracting with the firm that can if we go that route versus in-house, that we will be satisfied as to the likely success of them collecting for us. How this RFP process will actually work is we will send this out. If we get about the number of respondents as Macon County did, we should get 10 or so. How you do this is you start at the lowest one, and that's not the only deciding factor is the fee, but you start there to see, can they do all that we're needing them to do? The lowest one may not be able to do all that we need them to do. Not, we go to the second lowest. We look at that and see, are they able to satisfy all of our requirements, and do we feel comfortable with them as a firm representing Alamance County? If not, then we continue making our way up until we get to the firm that can satisfy staff's concerns and the board's concerns as well. So that's kind of how the process will work. So once we get the responses to the RFP, and if you look over on page 2 of the RFP, it gives you the time schedule that we're looking at. I'm hopefully issuing this tomorrow. Got a period for them to send in questions, and then their proposals will be due on February the 25th. After that, we'll take a couple of weeks to review the information that's been sent in, check references, do inquiries to make sure that the firm that we're hoping to go with, that they are able to meet our needs and our requirements and feel very comfortable with them. So that will be the process. We would come back sometime in March for the board to decide, would you like for us to do this in-house, or would you like for us to outsource this? If so, then here's the results of the RFP if you want to outsource it, and for the board to make a selection as to how you would like for us to move forward.
Was there an RFP used previously when we went with EMS?
And Chuck can better answer this question. My understanding is that we were doing it in-house before. Right. The success of that was not the greatest. I think that the firm that we're currently using came and approached us and said, you're doing it in-house now. Here's what's you're getting. Here's what we propose to do and what you could probably get by our handling it. I think that's maybe the process that took place. And they have been very successful and have done a very good job for us. Very good firm. It's just that the current rate that we're paying versus what some other firms will do it for causes us to really need to look and see.
But we need to make sure we get the same services.
That's correct. And that's where this RFP is very detailed and is requiring a lot of the firms. And I don't know that all the firms out there will be able to be able to do this, all that we're requiring of them. So that's kind of where we're at.
Any other commissioners?
How do you choose who's going to get a chance to bid on this?
Very good question. We've got the email addresses for all the ones that bid in Macon County. We're also going to put it on the manager's listserv, which will go out to just about all of the municipal and county managers in the state. So if they have some companies that they're dealing with that are different than than the ones that bid on Macon counties, they'll see it. We'll also put it on our website, so if anybody inquires into our purchasing site or section on our website, then they'll see that we're taking bids on this project.
Does the County Commissioner Association have a list of service providers?
I
don't know if they have a list, but we will get in touch with them as well and see if they have such a thing.
But if you take all of the counties in the state, and we've got a list of all of those and who's using their business, I mean, who's doing the work for them, and so we've got kind of a list of all the all the counties in the state, and I think there's probably 70-some that are outsourcing it and maybe 20-some that are doing it in-house. And so we kind of know who the other providers are in the state, you know, at least for counties. So we do have that list.
Any more questions?
And I'm assuming this company will bid on this, and that'll give you the opportunity if you decide to come in with a lower bid to do that at that point in time. Okay.
If there are no more questions, I'll entertain a motion to proceed with this.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed. All right.
Thank you, Tim. Thanks for the work.
Yes, sir.
Madam Chair, I do want to thank the work that Tim's done on this and our county attorney. Also, we had Frank Merritt's involved from the IT side. And Chuck as well, so can't forget Chuck. But a lot of heads have been put together to get this document where it needs to be and try to be as comprehensive as it can be, and I appreciate their work as well. With respect to the manager's update, I hope everybody saw a copy of the legislative goals, that the top five that were listed by the North Carolina County Commissioners Association. And also below that, we have some Alamance County local issues to address. There's about 10 goals there. Wanted to see if the commissioners had any concerns, anything that we need to add, anything that we need to change. If you like, I can read the county goals right quick.
Yeah.
One is work to change Jordan Lake rules. Number two is work to finish county line issues, and that is Orange and Guilford. Number three, local bill to allow tax payments to be received before deed can be recorded by the Register of Deeds. And that's what the Board of Commissioners approved a couple of months ago. Modernize annexation laws. That is a resolution that was approved by the Board of Commissioners. Protect local control of ABC system. Oppose legislation with respect to allowing municipalities to expand ETJs without county approval. And you do have a resolution in your packet that Commissioner Boswell has asked that we look at. Eliminate second primary and runoff elections. This is a cost-saving issue for counties. Usually you only get between 2% and 8% of the vote for those type elections, and it would be a cost-saving issue for our Board of Elections. Remove prohibition of PBH, which is Piedmont Behavioral Health System, from expanding. So Board is aware that our current LME is looking at PBH as the possible expansion partner. Currently, they're under a prohibition by the state of North Carolina from expanding, and we will request legislation to allow them to expand. Again, it's also to protect county jails, reinstate the reimbursement rates for states that are housed by the counties, and oppose legislation to increase time counties are mandated to house state misdemeanors. Again, that is so we don't fill up our jails at lower paying rates by the state. Those are state issues. So did not know if there was anything else we need to add. Any concerns that you had with this list?
Well, I would say that we had 54 proposals that the NCACC we had to vote on, and I'm the voting delegate, and these were the top five. And so if you'd like to see the other proposals, you know, I think it's on the website, and it's called, if you go to NCACC Legislative Goals, then you can read all of the legislative goals, but these were their top, and there were 83 counties represented there, so there were 17 that didn't show for the NCACC. So it was a very good, productive meeting, I thought. Ms. Trenicutt and I were in attendance there, and because I'm Alamance, I'm sitting right on the front row in front of everybody. So I had to behave. I couldn't even.
Couldn't slip out.
Couldn't do nothing. Had to be there. Thank you. No, it's my pleasure to be there because we certainly had a lot to go over that day and in 2 days. But we did finish up, and these were the goals. So I just want to thank you for allowing me to be there.
I have a problem with supporting control of the ABC system. Protect local control. I think it needs to be where an individual can own an ABC store. I'd like to, I think that it should be turned over to the...
Go to privatization.
Privatization of the system.
Well, I do want to tell you that the governor came to our meeting, that she was the first item on our agenda, and she says that she will not. Is that what she said, Mr. Honeycutt?
They can override her.
I'm just telling you that this is what she said, that she will not approve of privatization of the local ABC boards. So I just want you to know she said
that. I know she said. I'm aware of that.
Let me ask a technical question. If you privatized it, would the county commissioners have to approve allowing one outside the municipalities?
I have no idea.
See, right now, they're not allowed to be outside the city limits of the, like Graham and Burlington, mm-hmm. and they would have to come to us to open up a liquor store out in the county. And I would never support letting one go other than in the cities where they're at now. And I think if you privatized it, you would not only probably negate that need, but you would also, in my opinion, have, you know, liquor sold in the grocery store.
Well, that was what she said.
Yeah, that's true. I don't support that.
Now, that's exactly what she said. She said they will be in drug stores, they'll be in grocery stores, they'll be in every convenience store that stays open all night. Of course, I guess they might have a, you know.
I had somebody at a grocery store tell me, said, or Walmart, said, you'd be shocked at the people that go in the back, stand in between the aisles and drink beer until they get what they want, and
then they leave.
Can you imagine if it had Jim Beam back in the back?
They may not leave.
What they would be doing.
But she did mention that too, Mr. Sayles.
I've never known
about drinking like that. It's
true. Find them in the aisle.
So that's one of the reasons why she said she would not approve
chocolate
that.
Chocolate chips on the way out.
I think we would just have to leave that one for time being.
Yeah.
Then.
Okay. Thank you for your input.
But if there's no changes to the goals per se, those could be the goals that we do send out to our legislative delegation as well and make them aware. The other thing I do want to mention is we have been requested by Caswell County to meet with them within the next couple of weeks to discuss their direction for their proposed merger of the LME and the direction that they would like to go. And they wanted to talk to the Board of Commissioners directly about their plans and their intentions. At this time, they've not mentioned anything directly what they plan to do, but I do think they would like to have a sit down with our board in the next couple of weeks. If there is a time that is not good, we were not given specific times. They just said in the next couple of weeks.
I'm lost. I thought we were merging.
Well, the discussion right now is to merge the LME with PBH. But Caswell County may do some different things as well, and they just wanted us to be aware. So they do have the option to merge themselves.
And could we still merge if they?
Yes.
So it's not dependent on them.
It's not.
We,
it's,
okay.
I think they wanted us to kind of hear it from the horse's mouth of their direction.
Okay.
Have you talked with them about this? Did they still want it on the agenda?
They
at this
still
point?
Want it. They'd still like to meet with us.
Okay.
Well, could we not just do it in our next meeting agenda and have them as to make a presentation of what
they want?
I
would tend to agree with that. We've worked hard, and our chair has worked very hard, as you have, to get us where we are, and if they have, and I've attended the last two or three meetings of this, thanks to you, Madam Chair, but the ball's rolling in a positive way, I think, and if they have concerns or would like for us to know their position, we've got another meeting in 2 weeks, and we should invite them to come.
Well, what may be easier than a joint meeting, if the board is so agreeable, maybe have either the chair or the county manager come and make a presentation and just kind of tell us what
sufficient.
They want to do, if that is agreeable.
I think that's preferable.
I think that's
fine.
I mean,
instead of trying to get everybody together for a joint meeting?
I don't think we need a long discussion.
Well, can we not give the reason why they want to, why they want to talk to us about? Caswell had planned at one point to merge with OPC, which is what we looked at. Then we found out that OPC is merging with PBH that we never knew about at all until, what, last week? Week before last or something? Maybe I shouldn't be talking about this, but it bothers me that they did us that way, I'll tell you.
What bothers me is we're using all these initials and talking. Most of these folks are not aware of it. And I think if they want to come and present and we can lay the history of the thing so everybody can understand it, then that's fine. But to talk like this is really not being productive, in my opinion.
Well, I just want everybody to know, Castle's been kind of, you know, they don't meet any criteria whatsoever, and they're not even close, and we are, but we're not close enough either. So they're kind of left out in the cold. So I think we need to do whatever we can for them to assist them.
And if the board's agreeable, I will ask for them to either submit a letter of their intentions or have the county manager or the board chair to come and make a presentation to us.
I think that would be the best course.
Okay. One other thing I do need to mention, that our next meeting is right now scheduled for February 21st. If possible, we need to move that to Tuesday the 22nd. The 21st right now is a scheduled furlough day.
I think it's the 22nd on your calendar. I think it's already been moved.
Okay. It may be. Well, if it is, I apologize, but just wanted to make sure that everybody was aware that our next meeting will be February 22nd.
Okay.
That's fine.
I thought you were doing it because of President's Day, actually.
I wish.
He was doing it because of Commissioner Day.
Yeah, Commissioner Day. Your birthday. No, Tim's birthday.
Reagan's birthday.
Yes, there you go.
Okay.
But that's all I have.
Okay. Any questions of Mr. Hancock? If not, we'll go to the consent agenda. Or is there anything that needs to be pulled from the consent agenda?
I would like 11C and 11.
Where's mine at?
Okay, it's C1 and C2.
That's my C1 and C2s. C1 and C2. Okay, you have the floor.
All right, well, it's the health department here.
Is Barry here?
Barry here.
Yes.
There he is. Hiding.
Yeah, I understand that this is a WIC trip.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
And paid for by WIC.
That's correct.
And it's not required for any certifications or anything?
Well, they get credit as part of their nutrition and education for going to this. This is a national conference for the National WIC. This is the National WIC program. And they would receive credit and educational continuing education credits for attending. Yes, sir.
How does WIC pay for their own trips? You got on here that they're paying for.
Well, it's part of the funding that we have in our budget for educational conferences. So the money is appropriated. And one of the things, too, just to let you know in terms of being a good steward of these dollars, is that the estimation that you have in front of you are again, estimates. And we will work diligently to keep those costs down in terms of making the trip. And we have two folks who are both nutritionists who would be attending.
Where's this trip at?
It's in Portland, Oregon.
And they can't get these certifications anywhere closer by? Or
no, sir. This is the National WIC Conference of the WIC, National WIC Program. So this is the only event of its type in the country for our WIC program.
Well, explain to me the certification process. Now, again, you're saying they're going to get some.
Well, they'll get like continuing education
right.
units that would go towards, like for our nutrition director, Michelle. She's a registered dietitian and a licensed dietary nutritionist, so she needs a continuing education as part of to keep her certification as LDN.
But where else can they pick up certifications other than there?
Well, they can pick them up at other continuing education opportunities. And you just need to get a certain number of hours to keep a certification. And this is, they have no other similar type to this in our area. But can she can pick up continuing educations around our area? She certainly can, and she does that also.
Is this a conference that moves from place to place each year?
Yes, the different locations this year just happens to be on the West Coast.
And in the early registration or the dues, are we a non-member of this? It's got in the rates that we're...
I don't think she is a member of the National WIC Directors Association, no, sir.
Oh, okay.
You checked the block. No, it wasn't required for certification. Right.
That was for Candace. One of the persons, Candace is not a registered dietitian. For Michelle, it does. And as I was saying, she's our dietary director. She's a nutrition director, so she has to get the credits.
It's checked in.
Okay. All right, Candace is going to Kansas, right? Is that what you're saying?
Candace is
going. She's going to Oregon.
She's also going
to Kansas.
Well, she is not a registered dietitian at this point. She's a recent graduate and is working towards that, but she has not already got her master's in certification like Michelle has.
Okay, we're confused about you saying it's not required for certification.
Well, it is required for Michelle because she is an RD, and Candace doesn't have the certification at this point because she's not RD. All right. Hopefully she will be in the next couple of years because she's a recent college graduate, and we're trying to, through our workforce development, give her the opportunity.
Can you provide for us, maybe through county manager reports, the current participation in the WIC program?
Oh, absolutely.
If you will.
Yes, sir.
All right, that's all I had on that. And,
can we put that back in?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just hate spending money.
The next is Alamance County Sheriff's Office.
Madam Chair and Commissioners, it's great to be before you tonight. I'm coming for you to ask you to allow me to use our drug seize monies to send two polygraph operators to Newport News, Virginia, to undergo training from March the 21st to May 13th to be able to effectively administer polygraph test here in Alamance County. We're finding many times that because of the SBI that normally runs the polygraph and Burlington runs the polygraph, that we can't get our polygraphs run in time. If you've ever been involved in an investigation and you're talking to an individual and you know he's lying to you and you say, "Will you take a polygraph?" He says, "Yes." Well, then you call the SBI, "Well, I can get to it in 6 weeks." Well, by that time, he's got a lawyer. His lawyer says, "Shut your mouth. You're not taking no polygraph. That's it." Plus the fact that we will use this polygraph on our internal investigations involving criminal activity. We normally ask the SBI to come in and do the criminal investigation, but we do the internal investigation. And we are asking that two polygraph operators be able, or two people picked for the polygraph operators, to be able to attend Newport News, Virginia, where the polygraph school will be conducted.
And we're getting a new machine as well?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. And we're asking the money be transferred from our state vice to buy a polygraph machine.
So state vice is drug forfeit.
Yes, sir.
Money is
oh, yes,
is.
Sir. I wouldn't dare. Come. I'm not stupid.
I just want to make sure there, Sheriff.
Much.
I just want to make sure that wasn't new code for
no,
county
no.
funds.
No, no. This is drug seized money is taken from the drug dealers.
Have and, you already picked who's going? Or?
Yes, ma'am. We had applications, and matter of fact, this morning we met with the individuals and selected two individuals.
Will they be up there that long, or are they going to come home
on
weekends?
No, sir. Let me tell you what the man said. They'll probably get to come home one weekend.
Okay.
If you come home more than that, you won't pass. Because this is actually your psychology and physiology. Physiological examinations and stuff up there is about equivalent to a semester each in college. And these are important subjects in dealing with those individuals that are administered a polygraph. So.
And up to now, you've been having to go to Burlington?
We have gone to Burlington, but we can't, most of the time they're tied up, you know what I'm saying? And Burlington does have polygraph operator. I think we've used them a couple times. The biggest has been the North Carolina State Bureau investigation, and many times we have to haul them to Raleigh, to Greensboro, and even further. But the biggest problem is the weight of having to do that. And I feel like with the number of investigations we're involved in now, and even internals, we'll look probably 300 to 400 a year that will be running.
What level of crime can you have them? Can you ask them to take one?
You can have to take one, any level of crime.
Can you ask them if they're an illegal immigrant?
No response.
They're willing to take polygraph.
That's not crime.
That's right.
Last time it was. I don't know what it is.
Well, it is, but
let's just.
It's a crime.
It is, but it is.
It's a crime.
Let's say, I don't have the authority to do that.
It is breaking the laws of the United States. It's a crime. I don't care what
I just want to know more about it. I support it.
Well, you know, I would certainly not be before you if we were having to use the actual taxpayers' money.
I mean,
even though our
move.
Need is great for the machine and the operators, I think this will enhance our ability to perform criminal investigations much faster and more efficient.
You couldn't work a deal out with the machine suppliers to help in this cost a little?
Listen, this guy here is really helping us out, and that's all I'm going to say. Isn't that right, Mr. Britt? I sent two in the machine. You know, $26,725.52, and he gave us a deal on the machine and the training.
But the machine's no good without somebody that knows how to operate.
If you don't know how to operate it, the machine's no good.
Okay.
It's one of the best investigative tools that law enforcement has at its disposal this time.
Any more questions? Any comments?
No.
I think it's a good move. I mean, Alamance County needs this, as far as I'm concerned.
Let me tell you, if you could just be over there on any given day on the investigations that's being conducted and even some of the internal investigations we have to do, where you got to say a citizen's making a complaint and the officer, and it's one against the other.
Well, it makes us look a little bad that Burlington's got one and we don't even own one.
They've had one for years.
Yeah. I mean, you know, kind of bad not to own one, I think. So I think we ought to own one too.
We'll certainly use it, I promise you that.
Can we put this back on?
Sure.
All right. Yeah.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
Before we vote, I just wanted to bring up this. You're done, Chair.
Oh,
thank you, sir. Is this on here, Eddie? Because I was looking at the written. Is this the
The resolution against allowing municipalities the authority to expand? I have to thank one of our citizens, Mr. Reitenberry. He brought my attention to that. And basically, they had put it on their agenda this year to get this approved, the League of Municipalities. So we're just taking a proactive step to tell them we really don't think that that's the right move as a county without county approval.
Sure. And I agree.
So
I think we need to send them a letter, send our delegates a letter saying the same thing.
We'll be glad to send a copy of the resolution to
yeah,
them.
Yeah, okay. That resolution is taking more.
Was it unlimited what they wanted?
Well, I should followed up more than I've done it.
3 miles?
3 miles.
1 mile.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It was 3 miles.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Put that back in. Any other concerns on here?
Madam Chair, I'll make a motion and we approve the items on the consent agenda.
I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. The next thing is the commissioner's comments. Anybody got any comments?
I do.
Hip perceptive.
Illegal immigration is illegal because it's breaking the laws of the United States.
You are right. But that's not what the federal government looks at.
Well, the federal government is the one that creates, they're the ones that they have to abide by the same laws that we do.
Okay.
Whether they do or don't, that's a different thing.
Well, okay, is that you?
Yeah.
What I want to show you guys is I had the privilege to help with the groundbreaking at LabCorp. Today, FedEx dropped this off at my door. And I just want to show you what your commissioner looks like in a hard hat. So, but I'm really proud of this.
Let's pass it out now, please.
I'm really proud of that.
Need a close-up on that, huh?
And I got a really nice thank you for our support and participation to construct a new LabCorp facility. So I just wanted everybody to know that LabCorp is really pleased that we did that. So I didn't know this was coming. I'm going to tell you. I'm like, what in the world is FedEx doing? It might leave me something. So,
well, it looks good. Well, looks just hat like you with a hard
really
hat.
Good, don't it? Because I was fussing about it, messing up my hair.
You were.
Mr. Right. Manning was also there, and they said something. This man said it's going to mess up something. I said it's going to mess up my hair. But anyway, it was a good day, and we had a really right. good.
Do you wish to leave this with the county? Or we'll
I don't
home?
Care what they do with it. But I may take it short to my kids. They don't think I do anything. But anyway, other than that, that's the only comment I have. Does anybody else have any commissioner comments?
Madam Chair,
yes,
if I could, the one thing I did forget to mention, the board has been invited for a welcome home ceremony honoring Alpha Company, 30th Special Troop Battalion, North Carolina Army National Guard on Friday, February 25th. And that'll be at the Curry Center in Greensboro, beginning at 2:45. So I apologize for not mentioning that earlier.
Say 2:45.
Yes, sir. Friday, February 25th at the Curry Center.
Anything else?
Madam Chairman, may I make one comment?
Yeah, go ahead.
I think you, all of you, should recognize these scouts. I just told Mr. Freeman a few moments ago, we don't have enough scout participation. Believe it or not, I was a Boy Scout. But my hats are off to these kids that are here tonight, these scout leaders. And maybe not in this meeting, but a future meeting, maybe we should make a proclamation to have a Boy Scout week.
I think we have that. I think we have that.
Now, Ms. Cavanaugh?
Yeah, I think we have that. Do we not, Ms. Cavanaugh? I'm invited to something on Sunday for an Eagle Scout at St. Mark's Church.
Well, that's good.
That's getting his Eagle Scout. And anybody's welcome to go. If you didn't get an invite, let me know. You got one of those. Oh, no, his kids are in those.
Yeah, my kids will be there.
Yeah, his kids will be there. So, but thank you for that, Mr. Rockberry. And we can certainly work on that. Okay. If we have no more announcements, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.